To begin with, let me invite my colleague, Professor Subhasis Chaudhuri, and the Deputy Director of the Institute, who is the chief guest for the function. So we'll have those photographs first, and then we will request the chief guest to share his thoughts. I will then request some of you, maybe four or five of you, to share your experiences and your expectations from the main workshop. And then I will give my concluding remarks along with the vote of thanks. We'll try to finish by 3:30 or 3:45. Now before that, you all saw the AVU demo today morning. We are fortunate that the entire AVU team, the senior management at least, is here today, led by Dr. Kamal Bijlani. So I thought I will use this opportunity to introduce him and his team to all of you. So may I request Kamal and his team to come on the stage, please. So this is Dr. Kamal Bijlani and his team from Amrita University. I think I mentioned to you in my earlier remarks once that we started this distance education program when I started in 98-99, and we actually fructified it in 2000. We were using VSATs. And VSATs were extremely costly, the bandwidth was very costly. But internet connections were not very prevalent then and not very stable. As the internet started becoming stable, we were looking at some alternatives. I happened to be on the review committee of a project on behalf of Department of Science and Technology, which was then being executed by Kamal's team under Dr. Venkat, who is the Vice Chancellor of Amrita University, in developing this AVU. The early version of AVU was developed then. Subsequently, when we started the 1,000 teacher training program and then 10,000 teacher training program, we decided to exploit that. There have been a lot of interaction. We have given a lot of feedback on the usage suggestions, which they have been implementing since then. And as you know, that is the tool that we are going to use. So I would request Dr. Kamal Bijlani to briefly introduce his team and say a few words to you. Kamal, all yours.
We'd like to, you know, profoundly thank Dr. Deepak Phatak, you know, for the support and the cooperation that we have had for him. We have been walking this, as he said, this road together for the last 10 years and developing these things in distance education. And we are very, very happy to see all of you here today and see how much this program has grown over the years. Professor, you know, Deepak Phatak first wanted, you know, our dream was to have a 1,000 teacher workshop across India, and you know, we were finally able to do that. And then from 1,000 he directly jumped to 10,000 teachers. So you know, he's jumping this program by quantum leaps, and I think this program of having 10,000 teachers is probably a world record, and it probably has a place in the world records. And even though we have not formally done this yet, but you know, we will take it up at some point when we have a little time. So we are very pleased to be here. We are from Amrita University. Our chancellor is Amma Mata Amrita Nandamai, and she, you know, really encourages us to do social work and work on projects that are beneficial to society. It was her dream and vision that inspired us to take up this project, and we are very glad to be working with the national team and the ministry. Here we have some of the people from our team. We have around almost, you know, fluctuating between 125 to 150 people on the AVU team. And here we have Ashwini, Shivakumar, Vivek, Jayhari, and Kishore. So I would like to urge all of you, and I would like to say that all of you are part of our team, of the AVU team. And you know, all of you are going to be using this tool, And please give your feedback, you know, please give your suggestions. We want this to be, you know, one of the best platforms in the world, made by India, made in India. And we want to be proud of this. And we want to do this together with all of you. And we all feel very strongly that we should do something in India by ourselves. And Dr. Phatak and all of us strongly want to do this together. So we feel all of you are our team, and let's do this together. Thank you.
I would like to add a few things. As I think I had briefly mentioned that the AVU system is being made available free of cost to all educational training institutions, including ITIs. In fact, today only, Kamal also does not know this, but today we discussed with the Additional Secretary, Ministry of Labor, and they want to train 1 lakh teachers of ITIs on the new modules. They want to use this AVU, etc. The more important thing is an understanding that we have reached last year, the source code that has been developed by the NME ICT funding is first being shared with IIT Bombay, where we'll be directly contributing to additional functionalities. But more importantly, Amrita is seriously considering open sourcing the entire tool so that not only educational institutions but others will also benefit, and everybody across the world. And we have therefore decided that the day they announce the open sourcing decision, we start working on integrating it with the global EDX platform, so that an EDX AVU India version would be created for universal usage. So let's give them a big hand and thank you very much for doing this. Subhasis Chaudhuri is with us. Many of you may not know him well enough because he works in a different field. His expertise is actually signal and image processing. He's a professor of electrical engineering department, which has been the mother department for computer science program anyway. I used to be a faculty member in electrical at one time. He headed the department, and currently he is the deputy director of the institute. He is also member of an extremely important committee set up by the director, which has our other deputy director, Dr. Pandalai also, and several other people like head CD and head CEP and so on. And it is this committee under the mentorship of Professor Chaudhuri and Professor Pandalai that has recommended the acceptance of offering of the MOOCs program globally through EDX platform, and of the blended MOOCs program to the interested universities and colleges from next semester. And we have had great support from him and, in fact, the entire administration, and that's why we are able to run this program like this. So I'm very glad to invite Professor Subhasis to share some of his thoughts at this juncture. Subhasis.
Thank you, Professor Phatak, Professor Kannan, all the teachers from various colleges all over India, and the staff of the special program, the 10,000 teachers. It's really a wonderful opportunity for IIT Bombay to be a part of a special program which actually was originated or conceptualized by Professor Phatak in terms of reaching out whatever the expertise that IIT Bombay or many other IITs together that we have in terms of the quality of education and the betterment of the teachers that we have all over India. See, in India we have today roughly about 1.2 to 1.4 million students every year getting admitted into engineering colleges alone, right? So if you look at the AICT norm, that means you'll have something like 350,000 teachers required for all these colleges, right? Then you also have other colleges, not everything is only engineering, there are so many other areas. So there is a large number of teachers that are required to fill up all these positions in all over India, because finally our mandate as a part of the Ministry of Human Resource and Development is to teach or, you know, prepare the manpower for the next generation with the next type of technology that comes every day. There is a new technology coming up. It's the teachers, their responsibility to update themselves, to stay ahead with terms of what is being developed and impart the knowledge to our next generation, because they are the one who would finally build, I know, India. So this kind of thing is not possible in a one-to-one kind of situation that we have been doing earlier through our CEP program, where, you know, how much of one person can do or one group of faculty members by reaching out only 30 or 40 or 50 faculty members from different colleges. It's not possible. So that way, this whole idea that we teach a large number of them so that there is a force multiplier effect. Okay, we use all the technology that is there today. And luckily, this technology has become very affordable, and our government is also very keen that this particular technology reaches everywhere. So in IIT Bombay, we have this center for what we call CDEEP, Center for Distance Engineering Education. So this particular program, is idea is that how can we enhance the outreach of IITs in terms of imparting knowledge to all kind of teachers as well as for the industry professionals. It's not only, it doesn't have to be the only the teachers, but even the others. So that finally, all our next generation can be taught with the latest that is being developed today. So with that, we have several programs, and Professor Phatak is running one of the probably the largest number, as I think Dr. Bijlani said, that it is probably one of the programs which should go into some kind of a record book where you are teaching so many of them. So I definitely congratulate Professor Phatak for this initiative. And this has really been, we are seeing the benefit, and I'm sure that with years to come, we'll see this benefit even more. And we are very happy to know that there are several other faculty members also in IIT who are really helping him in terms of developing programs which is actually meant for such kind of purposes. Of course, we have another person in our dais, Professor, if I don't talk about his contribution in our outreach program of IIT Bombay, then I'll not be doing the proper justice, and that's Professor Kannan. He's also been an old horse here in IIT Bombay. He has been trying, he was the head of CDEEP earlier, and even now he has this very interesting program where he runs office hours for all people all over the world. I think it's mostly for India, but there are many places where they can ask questions. So it's called Ask a Questions. So this is another way of enhancing our outreach. And just I think yesterday, he has inaugurated this program for the discipline of physics. Earlier, it used to be only for electrical engineering. So I'm sure with more time, we'll have several other such programs will be coming in, and students all over India will find this very useful. So I think today is your last day, and I think many of you, I see you are here with your suitcases and bags you want to pack and go home, so I don't want to delay your departure from there, but I think I must say that it has been a pleasure having you here for this program, and I hope that the kind of program that we have started for last few years, it'll continue. We'll start seeing you more and more such participants. We want you back again with more, maybe some other kind of courses that we'll be running here. And I hope that this has been very useful to all of you. So thank you very much, and wish you all the best in your future.
Thank you, Professor Subhasis. You already listened to Professor Kannan in one of the sessions, but I have greater pleasure in inviting him, not only as the creator of spoken tutorials and so many other things. He and I have worked shoulder to shoulder for last several years trying to take this outreach program to really reach out to people. Today, I have requested him to share briefly his future vision, what in next 3 to 5 years he expects, the convergence of the technology, the efforts such as ours, and everything else to take this nation forward. Kannan.
Good afternoon. So you actually are exposed to spoken tutorials and also this 10,000 teacher training program. From the instructional methodology point, these two are completely different. This 10,000 teacher training program is a synchronous program. Everybody listens to the same idea at a given time. That's a synchronous. As opposed to the spoken tutorial approach, where the students are supposed to use the side-by-side method and to learn on their own. If they don't understand the concept, they are supposed to rewind the tape, listen to the command again, and try it out until it works. And because it is created for self-learning, it will always work. Okay? So in a given classroom, each student will be at their own timeline. Because somebody might have listened to it 3 times, somebody might have listened to it twice, somebody might have gone very fast, somebody might be listening to it in Hindi, somebody else in Bengali, Tamil, Hindi, English, and so on. So it's a completely asynchronous program. Okay? So these two, I'm taking care of spoken tutorials, which is completely asynchronous. Professor Phatak is doing a major synchronous program. And I have been thinking about the combination. Can we combine the two to produce something really good? One of the problems that happens in a massive program of this type is the feeling that the quality gets diluted, that you don't get individual attention. One of the reasons why such a program may get diluted, especially in a setting like this where people have to come, people come here, get a certificate, they get their TADA paid. Same thing is going to happen in the 10,000 teacher training program also. A lot of people are going to come. And our feeling is that quite a few people believe that it is a paid vacation, right? Somebody is paying TADA, I just go there, have fun, go back, right? I'm not saying that everybody, but there is a sizable number. And often the ministry and the audit section actually question us. You're spending so much money, but still some people are misusing it. What are you doing? So that is from the audit point of view. But from the point of view of the instructors and also the serious participants, there is a problem. Because these are the people who will come and say, time is over, or this is too much homework, I will not do it. All kinds of things, so they create problems. And of course, so large numbers, there is a problem that quality may be lower, because if there are only 30 people in a class, I can pay individual attention. Of course, it is not scalable. Imagine training all the 10,000 people through the normal QIP program that we conduct. in which we train only 30 people at a time. It would have taken 300 years to train all the 10,000 people, right? So it is that 30 people thing is not at all acceptable. Okay, it is not a scalable method. So the method that I have been proposing is, I believe that it is possible to use this combination to make this 10,000 teacher training program actually better than the 30 people contact program. That is my strong belief. I'll tell you how it is. So initially, in fact, Professor Phatak has already started creating things in the spoken tutorial form, self-learning modules, 10 minute, 15 minute. So that's going to be made available. So it is possible to make that available and say, the people who are interested in participating in the 10,000 teacher training program should go through this and appear in a test. And only people who pass the test will be enrolled in the synchronous program. You can have the passing mark very low. You could have it like 20 marks, 25 marks, whatever, 15 marks. What will happen is, if we do that, all the people who are not interested, they just come there for certificate, they will all fail. Because they're not interested. So then you see, of course, the number will be smaller, let's say 5,000. Or for that matter, let's take even one third, let's say 3,500 or something like that. They will all be motivated people. And they would also have gone through the basics, would have a good grasp. And at that time, Professor Phatak can actually say, come up with a problem. We are going to convert this synchronous program into a problem solving session. That's it. Because you know the basics. Why go through the basics again? Basics are already there. Then what happens is, a problem is presented, it is addressed, answered, then there will be 100 different views. So that same problem will be addressed from at least, say, 10 different angles. Because there are lots of people, lots of ways of thinking, the same problem gets addressed at many different angles, which is not possible in a 30 people class. In a 30 people class, you may have 2-3 views. So in that sense, if you have larger the number, the same problem will get analyzed in many different ways, and you get a very good perspective of the thing that is getting solved. So we could actually do that. It involves extra work. Of course, the people who fail first time need not worry, because this can happen again. We don't have a shortage, can do it again. Professor Phatak can go on giving these lectures again and again. You wake him up, he'll come and give a lecture, right? You wake me up, I'll come and talk about spoken tutorials anytime. Doesn't cost anything. So the idea is that we need to finally, at the end of this program, when you come out, you should be really good. And then if we, you know, teach, if we make our program in an effective way for 3,500 people, then, you know, there may be 10 Professor Phatak out of the 3,500 people who will come and do this in the future. Okay. Now, this program has been, you saw in the morning, Director General, who is in charge of ITI, wants to follow this. Okay. We have schools, much bigger thing, right? Of course, polytechnic colleges want to do this, science colleges, sociology colleges, TIS, I think, is interested in organizing something similar. So this methodology is fantastic. I think we have the great potential to reach out to use technology to leapfrog, which sometimes may not happen in some countries where they may have difficulty in introducing satellite communication equipment. In some dictatorial countries, they may not allow free expression. Here we are a democracy, we have the freedom. So we definitely can benefit by this technology. And this, the language dubbing that Professor Phatak is going to introduce, which we have been doing in spoken tutorial, I believe many of you have given names to that. And I think it is, it's this technology is extremely very good. Right now we are doing it manually, but in the future, of course, we'll have better technologies. But what is important is, this is another technology that is going to bring in the benefits of us being a large country. For example, I always say in spoken tutorial, a person, supposing a spoken tutorial is dubbed into Bodo, and somebody is listening to it in Bodo in Assam, and they will say, hey, the original was made by my brother in, say, Trivandrum, or in Gujarat, or somebody like that. So this kind of thing is possible, where we have original being created by somebody, dubbing being done by somebody else, and we will see the benefits of us being a part of a large country. Large country, lots of people, we can actually create lots of this good material. So the future looks very exciting, and some of you, I know that some of you are unhappy about that this program is offered only for computer science or people who have been teaching programming. I already told you not to worry, because what is required is that you should have taught this course once. You need not be a faculty member in computer science, so long as you have taught CS 101 in your college. But how do you do that? Every college has a shortage of such people. You may be in mechanical engineering, you may be in chemical engineering, physics, whatever. All that you have to do is to convince your administration that you can actually teach that course. After all, there is a shortage of people who can teach CS 101. How do you convince them? You have to know that. I'm saying, I told you that there are lots of material to learn this offline. Spoken tutorials are already available on C and C++. Please learn on your own and convince your department, your head, you can do that. And next year you can participate. So this is the message I would want you to give to all the people who may have registered, whom you might disallow. Tell them that they can prepare and then come prepared maybe next year or the year after. Okay, it is definitely possible in our system. That is, these are some of the small, checkpoints that we should establish to make sure our program gets better, so that it is good for everybody. Because we are spending a lot of money, taxpayers' money, it is important that we put it to use. Okay, with these words, I would like to thank Mr. Phatak for giving me this opportunity. He said 5 minutes, but faculty members can't talk for 5 minutes. Thank you.
I'm glad I provoked him to share his thoughts of future vision. So I don't think he's completely familiar with what we are attempting to do. And all of you must be smiling, because that is exactly the method that we are proposing to use in our workshop. So Professor Subhasis, you would like to know this. We have converted the conventional 2-week teachers training program for 10,000 teachers into two parts. The first week is online, and that online work they do for about 5 weeks. In every week they have to do 1 day equivalent of work. So they have to listen to something like a spoken tutorial for 10 minutes, and they have to answer quizzes and tests, and they have to do assignments. After doing all that, they come face to face for 1 week. Now the traditional coordinators workshop, these are the people who will coordinate 50, 60 teachers in each remote center, that used to be only of 1 week duration. It's the first time we converted that into a 2-week program. And all the people that you see here have already worked for 5 weeks, doing exactly the same thing that 10,000 teachers will do, going through the material, looking at the assignments, and solving some assignments. And what Professor Kannan would like to note, and I think Professor Subhasis would also like to note, is a unique experiment that I have proposed to start with this CS 101. One of the assignments to these people was that there was a 8-minute spoken tutorial on explaining if then else. All the workshop coordinators were required to listen to that spoken tutorial, then write a script in their own choice of Indian language and dub it, not necessarily the physical dubbing, but create an audio file and submit that as an assignment. This has succeeded. I have some excellent scripts written in Tamil, Bengal, Tamil. I assure you I can't read Tamil. But then I have 150 people on my team, and the nation is a great nation. We have all kinds of language experts here. So people have certified that Tamil, Bengali, Marathi and Hindi I could read myself. There are good efforts there. And now I will tell you what we plan to do together. We just decided yesterday that for that 10,000 teachers training program, all the lecture modules, which will be 8-minute, 10-minute duration, these 10,000 teachers will be requested to create, like the spoken tutorial, the script in an Indian language of their choice and the audio, and such groups will then be peer evaluated to find out what is the best. They themselves will throw up the best. And our ambition is that 2 weeks after the main workshop I think ends on 21st June. And as you know, all 10,000 teachers are required to complete one group assignment after the workshop, which they have to submit. That's a group assignment. So within 2 weeks of the completion of the 10,000 teachers workshop, we believe that all fundamental CS101 lectures to be given to the students will be available in all major languages of the country. And I think that would be an achievement, Professor. So this combining of synchronous and asynchronous thing, in fact, has always been at the back of our mind in all the efforts that we have made. And we are happy that what we are attempting to do actually gels well with the philosophy of both Professor Kannan and the Institute philosophy, as you mentioned. Incidentally, as a trial to do a peer evaluation and group assignments, the 380 faculty members here who are going to be the coordinators, they themselves did that task for last 2 days. They worked in a group assignment on the first day. Then they peer evaluated the other group assignments. And today, in the morning sessions, they made presentations of what they thought was the best. And what we have decided is all group assignments will be uploaded, shareable to all. So while there might be the so-called best selected by the peers, but all others are also visible and available. The only request they have made is to make available the email IDs and names of all participants in a file so that they can continue that interaction. So I'm very happy to see that things are coming to a fruition. We move with a greater this thing. But before my closing remarks, I would like to invite a few of you to share your thoughts, experiences, and expectations.
Yes, a very good afternoon to all of the delegates present on the dais and off the dais. Myself, Vikas Kamra. I belong to Sirsa City in Haryana State. My remote center ID is 1342. So I am teaching computer programming from last 7 years. So when I got information about this workshop from my remote center coordinators, he said that, are you interested to join this workshop? I simply said, yes, I am interested. Even I have not checked about the contents of the workshop because I have heard the name of IIT Bombay and computer programming. That is my interest area. Then after that, I checked the complete way of how this workshop will go on, 2 weeks work, 1 week equivalent online work in 5 weeks. So I felt very happy. I did all my online assignments in last 5 weeks before attending this main workshop at IIT Bombay on time. I taken help from my colleagues in my college, and when I joined this workshop in this institute at IIT Bombay, I felt very great. It's a great, I can say even up to now, it's a lifetime achievement for me that I have joined this workshop under the guidance of Professor Phatak and so many other teachers, many technical experts from IIT Bombay. And one thing I want to say, the simple CPP programming concept is very, very useful for me. And I'm very sure I'm going to teach to my students personally, even in the college time or after the college time, I will call my students and I will teach them how to do programming with simple CPP. So that is motivation I take from here. And I also met with so many of few people here from all over the country. I shared their experiences, like teaching experiences or other professional experiences. Taken the inputs from their students to them, and I have learned so many things. Even I'm getting little short words to say, but it's a great opportunity for me to be a part of this workshop at IIT Bombay. And I must say that it's the beginning. The main workshop is my main objective and my aim to successfully complete the 2 weeks IST main workshop for the people, or the person who are attending on my remote center. So I I am assuring all the people here that I will totally cooperate with the people who will participate in my remote centers area on their online work as well as in face-to-face interaction at my remote center. So I will assure you, sir, and it's my great pleasure to be here. And thank you very much. Thank you all. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Amrit Pawar. I am from Swiris College of Engineering, Pandharpur, city of Lord Vithala. It is in Solapur district in Maharashtra only. It gives me immense pleasure to be here with you all lovingly people. And here I have only few lines to say. And those lines are just for Phatak sir. Gurur Brahma, Gurur Vishnu, Gurur Devo Maheshwara, Guru Sakshat Parabrahma, Tasmay Sri Guru Namaha. See friends, in our life we meet many people, it may be from different background, but once we meet with them, about very few people we feel that yes, this is the person to whom I should support. That's Phatak sir. I felt here the only thing that I am experiencing right now. Phatak sir, the day before yesterday you said about our Swiris College of Engineering, Pandharpur, and I called our remote center coordinator Professor Dr. Mukne sir, and I told him about this thing. He told me the only one thing that you should take Ashirwad from him. That is the only thing, because he the only person who shows us such kind of new things. And when we enter into the IIT campus, every time they at my people, those who come here, they experience the same kind of thing every time, because there is something called as humanity. And sir, you speak with human kind of thing. Thank you sir, thanks a lot.
Good afternoon to all present here. I am Dr. Sarika Jain from NIT Kurukshetra, Haryana. I like to express my thanks to Professor Phatak, Professor Kannan, and his big team. Actually, being a lady, it was very difficult for me to move from Haryana till here, leaving my family there alone for a week. But when I came here and I am going back with a big carry bag in my mind, I am happy today. This is the first thing I wanted to say. And thanks to Professor Phatak, with all of his, he overwhelmed us with, I should say, his real world experiences and not examples. With every question posed to him, he has an experience of him to share with us. And thanks goes to his team that is always sitting there and supporting us in each and every way. They are there always, and the jobs that have been assigned to them, they have done in exceptionally brilliant way, I should say. Thank you so much. Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon to all of you who are here in the auditorium. This is Dhanaraj Dhotre from Sri Santa Gajanan Maharaj College of Engineering, Shegaon, a holy land of Sri Santa Gajanan Maharaj, and blessed by him. I'm very much thankful to IIT Bombay and especially Professor Phatak sir for giving us this opportunity to attend this kind of workshop. And definitely I'll be benefited with the help of this workshop, and I'll be carrying out the same message to my institute. And again, I would like to say that I'm very much thankful for the team of the Amrita University for making that software, AV software, as open source, because sir, we are conducting the same kind of thing in our institute,
like CEP, Continuous Education Program, and there we are calling the nearby institutes and we are giving training to them. But I think with the help of this kind of software, it's very easy for we people to conduct this kind of workshops, and other members will be benefited out of this. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Dignitary on the dais, of the dais. I remembered when I came here 2010 for the first computer programming workshop. Hardly there are 34, 35 people are there. And the same motivation, same inspiration, still today, we are getting the same motivational talks from Professor Phatak. And let me tell you one thing. Professor Phatak is not only telling you about computer programming and all that. I remember one lecture of a nation building also from him. He talks intensively. Very small things are there. I always show the that PPT which Phatak sir was using for their class CS 101 about one student's marks getting the grades, and it wrongly given higher marks and then all that. I always share that particular thought with my student and tell that, okay, ethical learning by ethics is also important. So not only programming, but that ethics also I learned from here. Every time I got something new, and every time I try to learn. So that's why Phatak sir also told on that day that it's a perpetual person. I'm a perpetual person from my institute always. So I always try to learn the new things and try to implement it at this in my college. Second thing, I must thank the, I think Professor Kamal Bijlani is there. I must thank that AVU team, because now we are the partner for the Amrita University, and we got an administrative login for AVU, and we are using the AVU for school level projects. So we have our institution have a 15 different schools, and we are using it to train some teachers. Now in the vacation we have started that particular training, and we have set up a small studio at my college, and we are using that. So thank to the AVU team also. Thank to all those TAs, all those support staff. Every time, because I was here from the first workshop, so I know lot many people. Sushant is there, Sajjan is there, so many people are there. I always remember them, and I always call them for the support. Thank for all those them. So let us have a big hand to all those, so as they can also get encouraged. And last but not least, सारे जहां से अच्छा हिंदुस्तान हमारा, ये हिंदुस्तान यहां पे बैठा है, और इससे बड़ा हिंदुस्तान आपको 16 से 21 जून तक वहां पे दिखने वाला है, मतलब आईआईटी से दिखेगा. सो हैट्स ऑफ टू आईआईटी बी, हैट्स ऑफ टू फटक सर, हैट्स ऑफ टू ऑल हिज टीम. थैंक यू.
A very good afternoon to one and all present here. I am Dr. G. Nalini Priya from Savita Engineering College, Chennai, Tamil Nadu. For the past 6 days, we learned many things, not only computer programming, the discipline, how the teacher must be. In our regional language, Tamil, there is one saying, room potu yosipangala, abdin solvanga. Okay, sir, Phatak sir has, yes, his thought process, okay. Meaning that for every action, we sit and in the room, we sit and discuss on each and every action. That is the meaning of that thing. Sir has, actually, for each and every action, he has made a great plan. So I came to know that how to plan. Okay, that is the first thing. The second thing is, for the 6 days we are apart from the family. Okay, even for ladies, we are just supporting our children. I feel it is very much worth for it. Then how to work? So as a teacher, we all know that we'll take class, we'll share our feelings with the students. But here is the place to discuss a great view about all the colleges and all the knowledges. Okay, so finally, Phatak sir told that your college is IIT Bombay, and you are the representative of Phatak sir. Like that he told. Okay, I am very proud that I'll be Phatak sir for my college. And I thank Professor Kannan. Okay, he's the previous DBMS workshop. He's the inspector for our college. I was wondering, he was talking our regional language very nicely. Then he told he is belong to our state. Anyway, India is India. Okay, India is growing. So I am proud to say, because of this workshop and because of this national building programs, India is growing. Then last thing is, we'll come to know what is the importance of open software sources. Because for my project students, hereafter I made one decision. We should suggest only open source softwares for our project building. Right? So with these few words, I'll conclude. Thank you. Jai Hind.
Good evening. I am Hari Shankar from Tamil Nadu Kongu Engineering College, and it's near to Coimbatore. The first thing is, I was highly inspired with Professor Phatak. That what I'm trying to say is, at the age of 60 or more than plus, he is still 20. You have to give a great applause. So everybody says that Professor Phatak is doing it. It's his work, he has to. But we have to learn that from him, that he has quite dedicated with his work. And whenever a person is doing a session, or even our own presentation has been taken by today's morning, everybody is supposed to be doing our mobile chatting or things like that. Even I have done it. But Professor Phatak has did. Sincerely, he is watching what he is for. That's we have to learn this. Really, really thank you, sir. And most probably, I often say that we teachers, what is the credit for us? And moreover, we earn that is quite low when comparing the industry people. That always I say that the more than of your salary, your student getting twice or thrice of your salary is your credit for you. Could you accept this? That's. And so be proud that to be a dedicated. Why I am saying this, most of the people that in Tamil Nadu, if you are not getting a job in industry, we are supposed to go for a teaching job, probably. So, but it should not be that. The teacher should be always dedicated with his teaching, and as well as prominent towards teaching and whatever it may be. So anyway, thanks to IITB giving this opportunity, and Professor Kannan and Professor Phatak, and who are all in the dais and as well off the dais. Thanks for giving this bigger opportunity. And anyway, thanks.
Good afternoon to all. I am Shumon Dev from National Institute of Technology, Agartala. Professor Phatak's that is total overall impression is becoming universal constant. So not to speak on that matter, I am putting my all devotion to him. I have a special request to Professor Kannan. That special request is, when we talk about biology, we have a nice structure of food chain and also ecology. But there is no structure of education, and there is no ecological structure of education or education chain. Maybe if we think of right now, lion is sitting here, maybe we are the small vegetarians sitting over there. So I want, sir, as sir is very great in formalizing things, sir, make a formal structure of ecology of education system, or a food chain of education system, where you can show it to everyone, so that we can have a striving, so that from lower we can go to higher. Because right now lions are only one or two, and everyone is talking about lion only, but we are not thinking of a system will eat up after sometimes, unless we are not preserving the eco chain, or the whole system will go down sometime. Thank you all.
I am Praveen Gupta from VIT College, Jaipur. I have 20 plus years experience in teaching plus industrial experience. Last 2.5 years, I am working as a head of department in computer science. The major difference which I have found here after coming this workshop, most of the colleges, like our college, nobody pay attention how the student is learning, whether it is learning or not learning. Including myself or my staff members, I always see कि teacher ने proper पढ़ाया नहीं पढ़ाया, course पूरा हुआ नहीं हुआ. All attention is the activity of the teachers. Here, the major difference I have found that all attention is on the learning of student. major attention, all the faculty members or the professors here teaching, they are paying attention ki whether student learning or not learning. This is the major most thing, we should learn it, and I promise that I will also learn this one, and most of us, we should follow this one and pay emphasis whenever possible. I know many of them, it is not feasible, nobody will listen your talk in your institute, but those who are having the capacity that they can implement it, or their colleagues, if they are working as a senior faculty member, then they can implement it. The most important thing is the learning of the student, and this is the one thing that I will carry with me and pay attention with on my students, that whether they are learning computer programming and other things or not. And I am very glad, I am very thankful for all the faculty members, staff of this this program, making this successful. Thank you all. Thank you.
A pleasant good afternoon to one and all gathered here. And it is my privilege to stand in front of you to give few words about this program. And for the past 6 days, we have grasped a lot of ideas from this computer programming. And only one thing I have to convey in this program, as our professor Phatak said, the queries which are triggered from the students has to be convinced from the faculty. Okay, for this only one aspect what we need is command over the subject, and we should be expertise in the platform, then only we can able to welcome the queries. Because as a faculty, we may have certain hesitation that if a student is going to rise for the query, we will tell him that you can just come later, or we will have certain hesitation to accept the query. So only one thing you have to keep in mind is just learn the language, learn the subjects, and try to implement it. So you have to understand the applications, whatever we are going to use, so that we can able to convince the students in a better manner, and as well as we can able to accept the queries, the interaction will be better, and as well as we can make the students a good citizen and good engineer tomorrow. And thank you for the things whatever is given by the IIT Bombay, and thank you for that.
Thank you very much for those nice words. In my concluding remarks, I would like to share my thoughts only on two aspects, some of which were mentioned by you. But before that, I must do something which is very important and which many of you have already voiced, namely to profusely thank the large team of people who have supported conduct of this workshop and who will support our workshop later. I hope you agree that it's very difficult to find such a dedicated team which work day in and day out arranging for everything. If there has been any shortcoming, I apologize to you on their behalf and on my behalf. But I believe that the work by this team has been excellent in all aspects. So let's give them a big hand. There's a couple of differences that people quoted between the other colleges in IIT Bombay. Let me also share with you one important difference. Although I have seen this spirit properly followed in some other institutions, but not everywhere else. The distinction between the technical administrative staff and the faculty is very significant in most colleges. It probably happens because hierarchically, the technical and administrative staff is always at much lower grades than the faculty. And unfortunately, the behavior of people at many places is what I call often grade dependent. I am very proud of the fact that in IIT Bombay, the respect that is given to the technical and administrative staff, the care with which their words and advice is listened to, is extraordinary. And let me tell you, my experiences and your experience will be, you respect someone else as a human being, and that person also lives up to that respect. I would like you also to take this back, at least amongst your colleagues. You see, you individually might be very well respecting the technical staff and administrative staff, but they should feel that their word is cared for, that they are cared for. And I think that will help us, because our dependence on the technical staff is extraordinary. You saw the AVU team here, okay? Sushant Raktade, for example, he's not a PhD. He can't do computer programming. But none of us can adjust the video equipment as he can, no matter what PhDs we have. So that is why our interdependence is extraordinary, and we should do that. So thank you very much, team. Great job, well done. As I said, I will take this opportunity to comment on just two things that were mentioned here. One was a mention about teachers. Somebody said that in Tamil Nadu, you take up teaching only if you don't get a job anywhere else. I think it's a deriding comment, because this fact is true about practically every human being except a few. Just go back and examine the life of every individual. Does every individual always get to do what he or she desires to do? 4 lakh people appear for joint entrance exam. 3,000, 5,000 people get admission. We know, we have been handling JE for decades. I have been handling JE data processing for decades. We know 50,000 people are as good. They don't get an opportunity. They go somewhere else. Does it mean they become bad engineers? Nonsense. They become as good engineers as anybody else. Now, here is my take. At any crossroad, as a human, I would have some desires, some aspirations, and as I would have some compulsions and some happening. Based on that, I get a certain path for my further progress, whatever it is. Whether it is being compelled upon me, whether it is because of the force of circumstances, or whether I liked it. But once I take that path, what prevents me from dedicating myself to that path and doing something so extraordinary that it didn't matter what I thought before I come to the crossroad? So here is my suggestion that you should share with all 10,000 teachers. No matter whether when they come to your place, no matter you tell them, no matter whether you came here because you did not get any job, no matter whether you have decided to stay in academics for all your career, no matter if you have decided to stay here only for 10 or 12 years, no matter if you have decided to stay for only 1 year, no matter if you have decided to stay for only one semester and seek some other job, no matter if you are going to be a teacher only for one day, but live that day, that semester, that year, such that you are nothing else but a teacher. And I will tell you, you will make a difference to it. Now, all that you need to do is, if you spend more than one day, you dedicate that second day also. As many days as you spend, you keep dedicating. I became a teacher at the age of 23. I am 66 years. And every day, I have been only doing that, nothing else. And I have been doing that extremely enjoyably. So it is doable. It is doable. And you see, so many colleagues of ours, all of you, the person who spoke here is head of the department. He is there for 7 years, 8 years. Okay? Do you think he is not working to the best of his abilities? He is. The problem is, in India, it is not easy for us to understand what are the best practices elsewhere so that we can adopt. And that is the importance of such workshops. Please appreciate one thing. When you come here, it is not only that you take away something. We also learn a lot. You may not realize it, but I have never permitted any single human interaction not to teach me something. And no matter what that human is. Because in every human being, there is something different, something new, something interesting, which you learn from and which you benefit from. The point is, most of our 10,000 teachers don't get an opportunity to interact with multiple people. They have no chance of learning from others. When they come to your remote centers, as I said, and I'm very happy that she repeated that your institute is IIT Bombay for them, and you are Dr. Phatak for them. But there's something much more. Your institute also has several good points, and there are takeaways that other people should come and take. And if your institute does not have sufficient number of good points, isn't it your job also to contribute? IIT Bombay is a big name, but IIT Bombay's name has been created by hundreds of faculty members and thousands of students and alumni who have built that name. It's not a single individual who does that. Likewise, you have to build your institutions. And likewise, you have to build a nation. And therefore, I come to the second point. Somebody said, "Sare jahan se achha." So I have one problem which I must share with you. You know, all of us, as we grow from childhood, we fall in love with various places, various people, various institutions. When we are born, we fall in love with our mother. Then we know our father, our siblings, our relatives. Then we fall in love with our friends. Then we fall in love with somebody. Then we start working, we fall in love with our institution. For me, my institution is the most important thing in this world. So we fall in love with that to the extent that we become half mad. Like that, we have intense love with variety of people, but some loves are more intense than the other. When I was a young student, I fell in love with an entity called India. And I fell in love with such madness that for me, that entity is bigger than God. I am a reasonably religious person, but even if my religious God was to come and say something or do something against my country called India, I would fight with God. And now I will tell you why I feel so strongly about India. I have studied history like nobody else would have studied. I'm an ardent follower of history and geography. Those were incidentally my pet subjects. I was driven into engineering, and that is how I'm teaching computer programming and other things today. But I'll tell you one thing. In the earlier session, I shared with you some of the weaknesses that our society has and which we need to overcome to be truly recognized as a developed country. Because a developed country is recognized by the discipline, by the intellectual capability, and by the social sensitivity of the people who comprise that developed nation. And we have to definitely move along. But there is one thing in our India which is unbeatable and which cannot be paralleled by any other country now or ever. And that is something very unique. First, the diversity. All of us are aware of the diversity. But how many of you know that there is absolutely no other nation on this face of this world which has this kind of diversity? You look at all kinds of problems, all kinds of characterizations. Ethnicities, all ethnicities exist in India. Religions, all major religions exist in India. Languages, 17 major languages. Okay. Is there any other country which is like that? China, which is bigger than us, has one or at the most two important dialects of the language. They don't have language problem. We have this problem, we have to translate everything into multiple languages and so on. Now what should normally happen to a nation which has 17 major languages, 10 major religions, 5 major ethnicities, and as an added attraction, we specialize in fighting with each other. We fight on language, we fight on region, we fight on religion, Tamil versus Kannada. You go to Bangalore, there is a problem. In Maharashtra and Madhya Pradesh, Hindi versus Marathi, Hindu versus Muslim, whatever, whatever. We specialize in fighting. And sometimes we fight very badly and madly, resulting in even carnages. That is shameful. And yet, we have lived as a single independent nation from 1947. We have lived as a growing republic with our own constitution since 1950. Is there any other example in the country like that in the world? No. That is where I keep saying that there are enough things about our nation to be proud of. We talk of research, we talk of Nobel laureates, we talk of Western things. We talk of if paper is accepted in IEEE or ACM, then only it is worth it, not if it is accepted in CSR. Why? Why are we shy of saying, no, we are proud of ourselves? Let me tell you two points of pride in our scientific research. Two areas I will mention. These two areas are such that no developed nation would ever like to share the most recent research in those areas, because they don't want other countries to become powerful in research in that area and powerful in implementation of what comes out of that research. You know what those two areas are? One is the nuclear sciences and the other is the missile technology. Okay. No country shares anything with you. I'll tell you one story. When the great Dr. Abdul Kalam visited my lab many years ago, Aeronautical Development Agency's lab, and I just asked him, sir, do you know one Kadam? Kadam used to be my batchmate from IIT Bombay in M.Tech. And Dr. Kalam suddenly stopped and looked at me and said, are you talking about N.V. Kadam? I said, yes, sir. He says, if my missiles are flying straight, Phatak, it is because of the control system strategy of N.V. Kadam. N.V. Kadam did not study in MIT and Stanford. He studied in IIT Bombay and developed those control systems at it. Why are we not proud of Abdul Kalam, of what he has done? He's a Nikhalis Indian. He did not study anywhere else. Look at our nuclear capabilities. Pokhran 2 happened not because of some Firang scientists coming here and helping us or borrowing the research from elsewhere. We did that ourselves. The great Kakodkar, who was one of the leaders at that time, is the chairman of Board of Governors of IIT Bombay. I'm extremely proud of such people. And let me tell you, you will find such individuals, not necessarily the greatest accomplishers, but ordinary people who will do something fantastic. Professor Vaidya mentioned the incident, so I must take 2 more minutes to tell you that, because I learned some additional fundamentals of ethics from that incident. I do not know whether I have shared this with you, but I was teaching a CS101 large class, as you know, and the mid-sem exam was concluded, and in one of the classes, I showed up a slide showing the names and the marks of the top performers in the mid-semester. And I requested everybody to stand up. There were, I think, 45 marks paper. We always have odd marks, not 50, 100. And the highest scorer was 44, and then 43, 42, etc., etc. I put those names up. That particular year, I had conducted the course in Convocation Hall, 900 students. We, of course, did that experience, experiment, and we started going back to 350 teachers. So when I read these names, I asked every person to stand up. There was some clapping, after all, top performer, etc., etc. As I finished that lecture and I was walking out of the convocation, all the boys sitting in the front said, "Sir, my friend's name is not there, but it will be there." I said, "What do you mean?" He says, "No, he has resubmitted his paper for recheck." You know, sometimes there are mistakes in the checking, 900 paper. So we have what is known as a crip session. Crip session means people cry over the shoulders of our TAs. So they generally submit those papers back. The protocol was that if you feel that a question has not been correctly judged, you should put an additional plain sheet, write down why you think your answer is correct and submit it. No discussion. Anyway. And he says that his score is 41.5, but he is sure to get 43.5, 2 marks. I said, how are you so sure? "No, sir, the answer has not been corrected. So he will definitely get." I said, "Fine. Whenever he gets those marks, let him write to me and I will be glad to include his name." 2 days later, I get a mail from him. He said, "Sir, my friend told me that when I get the answer book back, I should inform you if my marks have increased. I have got my answer book today, and as I expected, 2 marks have been added because that question was not corrected. So my score is 43.5. However, I just scanned through the entire paper once again, and I found that the original totaling done by TA was wrong. And the total was 2 more than what I should have got. So actually my score is only 41.5, which you may please note." I was so pleasantly surprised. Please understand, my TAs had 43.5 recorded in their record. The answer paper has been given back. There is absolutely no reason or rhyme for him to come back with those marks or anything like that. Our record is 43.5. How much guts it takes for a first year student who is competing in a terribly competitive environment to say, "No, I did not score 43.5, I scored only 41.5. In the next lecture, I put up a slide saying additional honors list and put his name without showing the marks and recited this incident. And I asked the class, "Do you believe that his name should be added to the honors list?" Huge loud yes. I asked him to get up. He stood up sheepishly. The loudest clapping I have heard in my life was for that boy. And please note, he missed his A grade by half mark. Isn't that ethics, sir? And who is teaching me that? A young boy. How many such boys and girls do we have as students in our college? Our problem is, as teachers, we are not sufficiently sensitive about students. We do not sufficiently relate to them, and we are not willing to learn from them. That is why somebody rightly said, our emphasis is on teaching and better teaching and still better teaching, but not on students learning and more learning. And one more thing, we learning from students and all of this. It is possible to do so. This country is 1.2 billion people strong. Believe me, there is no nation on the face of earth which can stop our progress. If we work together, we work with some dedication, and we simply do what we are charged with the responsibility of doing. We need not worry about other things. If we are teachers, let us be damn good teachers, and let us make 10,000 very good teachers. Thank you very much.
Can we all stand up and sing a national anthem for completion
Most
of this?
Most welcome. Absolutely no problem. We don't do that normally, but national anthem cannot be refused. It's a good idea.
Adinayak Jaya Hai Partha Bhagya Vidhata Punjab Sindh Gujarat Maratha Dravida Uttara Vanga Vindh Himachal Yamuna Ganga Utsal Chalati Taranga Tapa Shubha Name Jage Tapa Shubha Aashish Mage Gaye Tapa Jaya Radha Jana Gana Mangal Dayak Jaya Hai Bharat Bhagya Vidhata Jaya Hai Jaya Hai Jaya Hai Jaya 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 Hai
Bharat Mata Ki Jai
Okay, thank you.